turn our attention to the throne of mercy and grace, let us join in a prayer where we invoke the name of God. And where the name of God is present. Let us pray. Holy One of Israel, only one, creator, sustainer, redeemer, lover of mankind. Thank you for this day, this beautiful day of sunshine. Thank you that we have air and we're breathing it into our lungs and we're alive. Thank you, Lord, that with every breath we pronounce your holy, sacred name, Yahweh. Thank you for your presence. Remembering the words of Jesus, our Christ, our Lord, our Savior, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there. We welcome you this day, Lord. We welcome you in this presence. We ask that you would help us worship our Father, worship him in spirit and in truth, laying aside all the things that bind us, laying aside all the troubles that we have, laying aside our burdens, just for this hour, to give you worship and praise, to turn our lives more fully over to you, that with less of you in the world, we want to be more of you in the world. We ask the Lord that you would work through us, that you would use us in whatever way you see fit. Make us better disciples, that as we traverse this path that you have laid before us, as we follow your way that you have shown us in the person of Jesus Christ, that we would do so faithfully, intentionally, moment by moment, seeking your will for our lives. Come now, Holy Spirit, come in the midst of this worship of Bethany Union Church of Chicago, that what we offer to our God will be pleasing and acceptable to him. Bring our hearts love, Lord. Bring our spirits peace, and to our souls we ask, O Lord, enliven us to do your will in service now and forevermore. Let us worship the Lord, our God, creator of heaven and earth. This is our prayer in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. One. Amen. Let us stand and greet our neighbors this day.
This morning's choral anthem is African Hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah.
Today's scripture reading is from 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 through 18. Suffering for doing good. Finally, all of you are harmonious, sympathetic, affectionate, compassionate, and humble. Do not return evil for evil or insult for insult, but instead bless others because you are called to inherit a blessing. For the one who wants to love and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from uttering deceit. And he must turn away from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the Lord's face is against those who do evil. For who is going to harm you if you are devoted to what is good? But in fact, if you happen to suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. But do not be terrified of them or be shaken. But set Christ apart as Lord in your hearts and always be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks about the hope you possess. Yet do it with courtesy and respect, keeping a good conscience, so that those who slander your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame when they accuse you. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if God wills it, than for doing evil. Because Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, to bring you to God, by being put to death in the flesh, but by being made alive in the Spirit. This summer, 2017, we are cultivating compassion by learning and thinking upon God's word to us and for us. So today's message will seek to help us
fall deeper in love with God and to better know his love for us as we follow Jesus as one of his disciples, empowered, emboldened, and cultivating compassion in this world as we cooperate with the work of the Holy Spirit. For those that were here last night and enjoyed the children's choir from Africa, the Latotos, the stage was here so everybody could see them as the place was pretty well full. And we didn't want to be here until midnight, Earl, Chuck, and I taking it down, so we left it up. And I'm kind of liking it, to tell you the truth. I can see you, and we can see and hear the choir, and maybe we'll just leave it. We'll see. This morning we continued with looking at cultivating compassion. That is, putting our lives on purpose in the power of God to bring into this world compassion, His compassion. As Jesus has taught, you must. It didn't say you ought to, or didn't say you probably should. It didn't say, why don't you take a vote on, or why don't you decide. He said, you must be compassionate as your Father in heaven is compassionate. So we are looking at how this summer we can be more compassionate. And we saw Compassion International come with their truck, and many people sponsored children and looked at that last night. Some people sponsored and gave to Toto, to the orphans. And that's one way of showing compassion and being compassionate. And there are many ways. This morning, we are specifically going to do a look at what do we do with suffering. What do we do with suffering? What do you do with suffering? And as all things, we begin at home with our own little pruned hearts, and we look at our own suffering. Every human being suffers. It, by nature, is how we get through in this world. We all suffer, and in different forms. We suffer physically. Many of us, as we grow older, wake up in the morning, our eyes are open, and we get out of bed to see what's going to hurt today. And the knees remind us, and the hips remind us, but for the most part, we're moving, we're alive, it's good. But we do physically suffer just by growing older. It's the alternative that's not growing older. So we suffer on many different levels. There's no way to get out of being human and not suffering. In fact, all of the religions talk about suffering and why we suffer and what we do with suffering. In the Buddhist tradition, they say that suffering and the meaning of this life is to get rid of or end the cycle of suffering, but that suffering is always present and there. The meaning of life is suffering. Well, we don't look at it that way. We look at a God who redeems all things, including suffering. That God wastes nothing, including our tears, including our pains, and He finds a way to even have that benefit us. Now, it's awful hard to convince me that suffering can benefit me. The one thing I don't like to do is suffer. I don't like suffering through this allergy. I don't like having a hangnail. Okay, when it comes right down to it, I admit I am a wimp when it comes to pain. Don't like pain at all. Don't like to hurt at all. Don't like to suffer at all. And let's be honest, fellas. Women do better with pain than us guys. When we get a cold or we're sick, the world has ended, correct? It's done with. They continue to go on and take care of us and seem to do much better with pain and suffering than we do. This morning, I want to look at what you and what I do with our suffering. Because until we answer what we do with our suffering and how we manage our suffering, our pain, what we do with it, how we let it affect us or not affect us, we can't be really compassionate with other people, because compassion is about recognizing suffering, and responding to it. 1 Peter, we just had read to us, from it we heard, we were told to love one another as brothers and sisters, to love one another as family. Now, some of you, I don't want you to love me like you love your family, because I know how you love your family, and I don't want to be part of that. But those who love like brothers and sisters on a good place, that is what we're called to do. We're to see each other as family. And as family, we are to care for and love one another. And it says, be compassionate. Be compassionate. Be compassionate. And you're blessed to be a blessing. It says, suffer for righteousness and be ready to explain the hope you have in you. Suffer for righteousness. You're going to suffer for something. You're always going to be alive. You're going to suffer. It goes hand in foot. A good day, you may not have any suffering. But there's enough pain in the world to really escape that is impossible. So suffer, they say, for righteousness. That is being in the presence of God, in the will of God. Suffer for that. We also hear that we are called to choose how we will respond to our suffering. So, what do we do with it? What do we do with suffering? Most of the time, we want it to be ended and over quickly, right away. We want it to just disappear. We have a headache, we take two aspirin. Whatever is going on physically, emotionally, if we're having a heartache, we want it to stop. If we're having mental fatigue, we want it to go away. Whatever way we are suffering, we look for the suffering to end. And it may, and it feels good when it stops, but you know it doesn't end. It'll pick up again another day. Suffering goes along with living. On this side of the dirt, we will always, either spiritually or physically, emotionally, mentally, in our relationships, we will suffer. We will suffer because it's an imperfect world filled with us imperfect humans. We're called to embrace it with compassion. What does that mean, to embrace it with compassion? Compassion, by definition, can't be had unless there is suffering. Compassion has to do with suffering and alleviating suffering, but not just alleviating it, embracing it. Embracing it. It is said, and I think correctly, that anything that you resist persists. Anything you resist persists. So when you want to try to deny it, when you want to try to do away with it, when you want to just pretend it isn't there, whatever it is, it will persist. The only way that we can deal with suffering in a biblical and humane way is to embrace it, to enter it, to go through it, to recognize it and to name it and to live in it. We embrace suffering by receiving compassion from someone else who gives it to us. We embrace suffering by giving compassion to ourselves. We embrace suffering by receiving compassion from God. This morning, I want us to all practice and get good at receiving compassion and embracing it. So we will give ourselves opportunities to do that from other people, from ourselves, and from our Lord. Our care circuitry, how our brains are wired, how God has created us, our brain actually releases oxy and other natural opiates when we receive, when we embrace compassion. Our brain is turned on by that. Our brain, when we receive, we're naturally wired to receive that. And our brain rewards us, gives us the good stuff to help us feel better and to comfort us. So compassion actually has a physiological response in our brain and in our bodies. Experiencing compassion also scientifically has been dramatically proven. It reduces every form of mental distress, relieves stress, anxiety, and depression, and other negative emotions. They have done study after study to see that as a marker, compassion given and received makes things more tolerable, makes things better. When you're giving compassion, you are doing first aid. You're doing mental health first aid, emotional first aid, spiritual first aid by embracing that compassion. Remember that compassion is a verb. It is a verb. It is something that we do. It isn't something that we just drop off at the door and ring the doorbell. It is something that we enter into. It's our persons. It's incarnate. It's what Jesus has shown us. We actually enter into someone else's life and help them. Well, again, it begins at home. We can't give away what we don't have. And so we need to learn, we need to come to a place where we embrace compassion that we give to ourselves. And it's okay to give it to yourself, because as you give it to yourself, it overflows and you give it to other people. Now, we are embraced by someone else's compassion, and we receive all sorts of good stuff. And it is selfish to not let others be compassionate to you. Sometimes we want to be the helpers. We want to be the ones giving the compassion. We want to be the ones that are helping out, that are making a difference. You know, but you cannot do that and not also receive compassion from others, because others need to give compassion as well. And if you refuse to receive it, then you are denying them a part of their humanity. If you're going to give compassion, you have to also be available to receive compassion. I want you to think for a moment of the most compassionate episode in your life from a person who you received compassion from. It could be a parent, it could be a grandparent, a neighbor, an adult, a friend, a spouse, anybody. But think of a time when you were hurting. Didn't have to be physical hurt. It can be. It can be emotional. It can be mental. Any time when you just were down and out, when you were hurting, do you remember somebody being compassionate, nice to you, honoring you as a human being? Think about that for a moment. Think about that person. That person who maybe just gave you a hug, or held your hand, or even passed you a box of Kleenex. That person who was just there, didn't have to have words of wisdom, just had to be there. Being there, incarnation, is how compassion works. Can you remember a time when someone cared for you, when someone made it okay? How many people remember a grandparent making it okay? Couldn't grandmas and grandpas always, couldn't they always just, it didn't matter what happened, grandpa and grandma could make it all better. They just sort of had that compassion button. Think of other people, a teacher. I remember a teacher. I had one good teacher in all elementary school. But she was very good. And I remember her compassion. You remember a teacher giving you compassion, honoring you as a human being. How about giving yourself compassion? Do you remember self-soothing? That is something that all species learn to do. This little puppy that I have now is something, you put it in the kennel. It has to have a little kennel time, because one of the things it has to learn is how to self-soothe. Because not all the time will you have somebody there to give you compassion. You'll need to learn as well how to self-soothe, how to give yourself compassion. And that's important to do, to tell yourself that, hey, you may feel miserable, but you're okay. You may feel like you're the scum of the earth, but, you know, feelings are fickle things. That'll pass. You'll be fine. To give yourself compassion, to wish yourself well and blessed and happy, and it'll be okay. It's just a moment, and this too shall pass. Do you know how to give yourself compassion and the self-talk? We're going to do that in just a little while. And I'm going to help you do that. It's something that is prayerful. It is something where we open a channel and let God in. And that is the third thing. We allow the Lord to embrace us with compassion. You know what God does best? That first slide that was up there about the little guy fixing, mending the hearts. That, I believe, is a great picture of God. God loves on us. He doesn't know how to leave us alone. He doesn't know how to do anything except love us. And He wants to love us. And when we allow Him to do what He does best, we just sit and let Him embrace us. Let Him love us. Let Him tell us in our heart of hearts that it's okay. That the end of the story, love wins. That at the end of the story, justice prevails. That at the end of the story, only goodness and mercy will endure. So we allow the Lord and His Holy Spirit to speak to us deeply. I want you to think about Jesus, whatever image you have of Jesus. There are many images, and God is so good that He will allow us to envision Him in any circumstances. You may not see this as Jesus. You may see Him differently, but I need you, if you would, just get a picture of Jesus in your mind. Who Jesus is to you as a living, breathing human being, as a person, somebody real, as God wrapped in human flesh. Now, what I'd like you to do is, with a helpful little background music, I'm going to lead you through what I hope will allow you to be compassionate, first to yourself. So if you would, in a prayerful mood, if you want to close your eyes, you're more than welcome to do so. Keep your eyes wide open. But I want you just to relax. I want you to be here in the presence of God. And I want you to extend to yourself permission to be compassionate to yourself, to think how dearly you are loved by so many. Even if you're at a period and a place where you can't even think about all the people that love you, know that they do love you. Know that you're in a place that is safe. Know that you're in a place where you're honored, a place where you're loved. And pray for yourself that you will be happy. May this day you be safe. May this day you be loved. May this day you be embraced by all that is good and honorable and hopeful. The Lord do what the Lord does best. Just sit in His love. Let Him embrace you, put His arms around you, and just hold you. You have no place else to go right now. You have nothing else to do right now. Just let God love on you. Let God make right now okay. To let you know that it's safe. To let you know that your sin is forgiven. To let you know that He created you and had you in His mind when He first created the world. Knew that this day and time would come when He would have the opportunity for you to once again greet and meet Him. And to just acknowledge, to give yourself permission to believe. Really, that's all believing is. giving ourselves permission to will, that though we can't see it, though we can't prove it, though we can't touch it, we can choose to believe it. For there are things greater than touching, greater than seeing. There is a knowing that the Spirit gives, a knowing that is a gift to you and to me. Just let God embrace you, soothe you, and let you know that now is now. The past, whatever happened or happened there, doesn't belong to any of us anymore. It's gone. Forever. It's gone. Tomorrow, we're not promised. But today, we're alive. Today is filled with possibilities, potentialities. Today is just a good day to be human. Oh, God loves humans. It's the crown of His creation. He loves you. He loves you so much that He became one of us. A human, just like you, just like me. And He went to battle for us and defeated death and sin on our behalf, that we might live with Him throughout eternity. That's how much you are loved. That is how much you are embraced. That's how dear you are to your God. So let Him have whatever it is that is troubling your heart. Give over to Him your worry and your anxiety, knowing that in this moment, here, now, God is for you. And if God is for you, who dare be against you? All of the universe was created for you in this moment. In this moment to let you know how dear, how worthwhile, how righteous you are. Because you are a container that holds the very presence of God. God sometimes can seem elusive, can seem distant, but it's not His choice. He's always there. He doesn't know how to leave you alone. He's always chasing after you. He's always knocking and seeking you. You can say yes to Him. You can let Him love you. And in so loving you, He claims you. You are one of His and His alone. And nothing created in the seen or the unseen world can separate you from God's love. It is yours, and it is yours forever. This is what Jesus has done for you, for me. However you are suffering, in your mind, or in your heart, your spirit, your body, the name that is above all names, the name that is spoken and demons flee, the name where goodness resides, the name where blessing endures, the name of Jesus Christ. Remember, you are God's and God's alone. And you are okay, you are well, you're alive, and this day, the now, is yours. May God bless us. May God continue to bless others through us. And may we change the world. Amen.
Amen.
There are many ways to cultivate compassion. Many ways that we are called to be compassionate to ourselves, whom God loves, compassionate to one another. We're compassionate in our own home to ourselves, and then it spreads out. There's also compassion in the world. We saw in the last few weeks Compassion International. We saw Watoto and the children. And today we get to celebrate that God is doing through one of our own, Dr. Macy Green, who will leave this week to go to Tanzania to take her training and her medical expertise and her love and her compassion in heart to the people there, with all of our prayers and all of our hopes and wishes and all the medical supplies and financial support that we are sending along with her. So I would ask Dr. Green to come forward at this time that we might commission and bless this trip. So Dr. Green, you want to come up here? And because what is important we do as a family, we all need to sort of get to the center aisle. So if you want to stand up and get to the center aisle so we can all lay hands upon each other, so we can lay hands upon her. So we got to get connected as we commission and bless her off to Africa. So everybody get hands on somebody. A shoulder, a hand, get connected. Let's pray. Lord, our God, our Holy One, upon your daughter, our sister, we ask that you would surround her with your angels of mercy, protect her and her team as she goes forth this week to Tanzania. Let her be receptive to the people there, that they might know her good heart, for she brings medicine of the soul as well as for the body. Let your love in her, Lord, just overflow, and let them who are in desperate need see her, receive her touch and care. We ask, O Lord, that you would do this in a mighty way, that you would send our love in her heart, that she would give that away to those who are there, that brothers and sisters whom we may never meet until we get there into the kingdom will know that they have friends, people who care here in the United States, here in a place called Chicago, which may seem so far, far away from them. But let them know, Lord, your kingdom, though it be large, it is very small. And brothers and sisters, all we are. So Lord, protect and guide her. Be with her. Be with her family as she is gone, giving them the understanding and the care that she's in good hands and doing well. Help her, Lord, until she returns here again with wonderful stories to share with us on your miraculous gifts. We ask, O Lord, this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. As Jesus has said, Macy, go and feed my sheep. Amen. Back to your seats and get seated, and then I'll ask you to stand that you may receive the blessing as we go forth this day to be a blessing and to make the world the place that God had intended for it to be. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be compassionate to yourself, be compassionate to one another, be compassionate to God's word, even as God is compassionate to us. Let they who come in contact with you this day know that God is good, God is great, and he loves us so. Go forth and change the world. Amen.